Small and medium enterprises, they're considered the backbone of the Philippine economy, providing more than 60% of employment in the country.
Thanks to the rise in fintech, access to loans for small business owners have become easier, but a lot still need to be done. To talk to us about the importance of lending to the underserved, we have with us in the studio Robert Jordan Bobby Jr., Vice Chairman and CEO of Asia Link Finance. Hi, Bobby. Thank you for joining us.
Salve. Hi,
Ron.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah.
So that huge figure you told me earlier, $220 billion, that's the size of this industry.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. And so there's still a lot of things to be done because apparently not a lot of banks really lend to the MSME.
Yeah, actually, yeah, that's true. Because if you look at the 2020 figures of the Asian Development Bank, the lending by banks to the MSME is only about $10 billion a year. The non-bank financial institutions like ours are lending to MSMEs is about $5 billion
per year.
So it's really far, far from the $220 billion that MSMEs need for their operation.
Why is there, I mean, for a country relying on almost 100% on MSMEs, the industries here in the country, why is there that kind of a big gap still?
Well, it's really because probably there's a lack of government policy to really, direct lending, redirect lending towards the MSMEs. Mm-hmm. If you compare our country to, say, Vietnam, in 2020, about $70 billion went to the MSME sector, as opposed to our $15 billion in the Philippines. So there's really a big gap as far as the financing or funding of the MSMEs. And I think it's something that we should look into. Our government should look into so that we can support the growth of these MSMEs, which is really vital to the to our economy as far as generating employment is concerned. As you mentioned earlier, about 60% of the workers are really employed by the MSMEs. And only about 40% are by the large corporations. Mm-hmm. So if we are able to address this issue, then employment will increase, and also the poverty, hopefully, poverty incidence will also decrease. 20% of our population is poor. The reason being is that because of the lack of employment opportunities.
And lack of access to capital. But the central bank requires banks to lend to MSMEs. The GFIs are also required to lend to MSMEs.
There's a requirement by the BSP, but most banks prefer to just pay the penalty.
That's right.
Instead of lending, having the allocated funds lent to the MSMEs.
Why is that? That's just, amazing to find out. Why would they just rather pay than just lend?
Yeah. Well, the reason being is that it's really difficult to lend to the MSMEs. Mm-hmm. The risk associated to lending to the sector is very high.
And the costs as well of acquiring clients from the MSME sector.
And also the skill set needed. Because I used to be a loan officer in a commercial bank. And
sorry, I was teasing you earlier. Are the clients you ignored in the banking industry.
Yeah, because when I was a loan officer in the MSME sector, the smallest client I was lending to was 30 million. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't, even if I wanted to, I could not serve the smaller accounts. Mm-hmm. Because I am also under pressure to give profit to the bank. Mm-hmm. And also I can handle only about 50 customers at a time. More than that, I cannot, because the demand, the work demands a lot from us. If you have a customer with a 100 million credit line, you have to do annual renewal, aside from the fact that you have to go to the loan committee, to the executive committee, and have the accounts approved there. And then you have to justify why you have to give them a credit facility. And also the movements for these accounts are really, you know, it's difficult because there are accounts that have a lot of transactions. And whenever there are transactions, you have to go back to the loan committee to have it approved. So, and the other reason are, you know, loan officers like myself were very piratable. A lot of my colleagues went abroad in the Middle East and somewhere else, in Singapore, because of the skills that we have, and you know, the offers are really very tempting.
You know, I read an article by the PIDS. There's an article or a study by Gilbert Lianto and I think Mario Lamberte. What you're saying is the reason why most of the small businesses in the Philippines, where they source their capital is one, from their own money, loans from their kamag-anak or the OFWs overseas, 5-6, where the costs are too high. But you started this business in 1997, right before the Asian financial crisis. And so I was wondering, when you started this until now, how far have you grown? Has the business model worked? And you're saying your loan releases are $2 billion a month now.
Yes, we started with very little capital, 3 million pesos in 1997.
Ron can start doing that.
I wish.
So we've grown our loan book now to about almost 25 billion. There are three lending companies. And on a monthly basis, like Asian Inc., for instance, released more than $1 billion last month. So the two other companies, Global is about 500 million and South Asian Inc. is about 300. So roughly about 1.8 billion in releases per month last month. So we're looking to grow these releases over time. But our constraint really is the funding, because we source our funding not only from capital, but also from credit lines from the financial institutions. A lot of financial institutions or the banks are really been helping us, and we're fortunate that they've been there for us. But you know, a lot more has to be done, because in fact, we are not customers of, we don't have credit lines from the biggest, the top three commercial universal banks in the country. We only have credit lines from the medium-sized banks and the smaller banks. So the banks, we're still under leverage because of the fact our debt to equity ratio is only about 2.5. So there's really room for us to grow. Compared to banks, their debt to equity ratio is about 5, 6, 7. So because banks don't really want to give us more because there are inherent risks, But I firmly believe that the risk is really exaggerated in the sense that you know, our average loan size is only about 300, 400, 500 thousand.
These are for trucks, cars, and these are repossessed properties.
No, these are really small and medium businesses who
business loans.
Who mortgage their property, their cars, their trucks, to get funds for working capital. To pay for, let's say, immediate needs, like salaries, or to pay for inventory that they've ordered. So, because of our accessibility and also our fast processing time, because we can process a loan within within 1 day or 2 days at most, 2 to 3 days at most. Then we are able to serve our customers. Our rates, we've been trying to lower it over the years, because we know that SMEs or the need the lower cost capital, lower cost of capital. Yeah. But our concerns also, our concerns also is that our cost is our borrowing cost is high. You know, Salve, right now our average cost of funds is about 8.5 to 9%. The funds that we get from the banks.
Yeah.
So that's why our effective rate is also kind of high because of also of our intermediation costs.
Despite the challenges that, that lenders like you may face in filling up this gap, is there a number of is there growth in the number of companies like AsiaLink servicing MSMEs in the country?
Yes, you know, right now we serve at least 6,000 customers every month. So
But are there other growing number of companies like AsiaLink that are putting up shop here in the country and lending to MSMEs?
Well, unfortunately, there are not really many of us, no, because there are a lot of financing companies who are more on the consumer side of the business.
Right.
Like if you buy appliance, of
buy now pay later schemes.
Yeah. So. But on the productive side, like us, there are really not many of us who are doing it. And I think part of the reason that we're successful is because of our discipline and our focus. Mm-hmm. We've been in business for almost 26 years. No? And the reason is really our low attrition rate as far as our officers are concerned.
And your NPLs are...
Our NPL is the latest that I got was less than 1%.
It's low compared to the big banks.
Yes, because the I think the banking industry is about 3%. No? So, so somebody asked me why we were able to do that. No? And I think it's really the determination on our part. Because whenever we have a loan product that exceeds a 2% pasture ratio, we stop and we assess our position. Because everybody in the organization has to be really focused on the target or the objective of having less than 2% pasture.
Right. If you look at the demographic story of the Philippines, you'd expect this industry to grow so much faster in the next 10 years. How much do you want your market share to be of that growing industry?
Well, if we have the funding, we can really grow. And we think like our some of the government financial institutions have been very supportive of us, like Land Bank and the Development Bank of the Philippines. But I think they can do more as far as funding us is concerned. And I know I want to assuage the fears of this financial institution as far as we're concerned, because we're really professionalizing all our operation. We want to be as transparent as possible to our investors, to our stakeholders, and personally, because when I because it's a, I think for me personally it's a service. I saw, when I meet my classmates who work in government, they always, are very proud that, Brad, or, servisyo namin sa bayan, no? And when I, I couldn't answer them, what kind of service have I done for my country? I used to be a scholar, and, it's a way of, for me, of giving back to my country, to society, and I always tell our people that we have to pay the correct taxes, whatever it is.
Bobby, you mentioned a while ago that you started in 1997. What may be the best story you could share to us on how an institution like yours has been able to push MSMEs to success?
Well, I think for me, and for most of us, it's a satisfaction of seeing our customers grow their business. And we've met a lot of our customers, and they really thank us for helping them.
Imagine if you could say you funded the next Tony Tan Kakchoy.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right?
Right.
Oh, yeah. All of these, that's the idea of nation building, that you can help these small businessmen grow their business because they have access to capital that's not too expensive.
Yes.
Because the industry is structured properly and supported well. But on the my final question will be, there are a lot of different organizations now that are tech-enabled, AI-powered,
yeah,
to measure the capability of their clients to pay their loans. Some of them are on the consumer side. Some of them are offering business loans. How are you going to compete in that environment?
Well, we're. I know it's a threat, maybe for our business model in 5 years, 10 years time. But we're also transitioning to that business model. We've employed almost automation in every aspect of our business, in terms of credit scoring, in terms of operations. But I think the limitations of this model is that you can only expose so much to a certain customer, because the methodology and the process is really to lend to unsecured customers, and the higher the amount goes, the riskier and the more tempting it is for the person to abscond or not pay his loan. No? So that is the problem. No? As opposed to our model, where we look at his business in its entirety.
Right. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for being here, Bobby. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Bobby.
Thank you, Ron. Thank you.